Thank you, everyone. Thanks for joining me today. I'd like to talk to you about message in a bottle, which is my way of trying to find hope in a sea of security breach data. I know we're all inundated with breach information. Certainly I am. I've been giving breach presentations for many years now, particularly from 2009 on. And one of the things I noticed in the past year to 2 years is the amount of information coming in is almost overwhelming, if not overwhelming. So I'm looking for a ray of hope, a silver lining in the cloud, which is kind of contrarian for myself because I tend to be very critical, a nitpicker maybe, and I finally decided I'm gonna bring out the message that I think everybody wants to hear. So what we're gonna talk about today is the background and the data, which I usually talk about, and you'll find elsewhere. Then I'm gonna do an analysis, which hopefully is a little bit different about who is doing what and how they're doing it, so that we can talk about in the end what it all means. The objective again is to find really some concrete steps and to talk about what we can really do to address the breaches that have been skyrocketing, at least in our minds when we read about the disaster and the catastrophe in the news. So let's talk about background and data. First, some definitions. I think it's really important to lay out that there are breaches and then there are breaches. You know, the famous quote by Twain was that there are statistics, lies, and then there's lies, damn lies, and statistics. And so I think his point there is that you really have to understand, you know, what you're dealing with. And in breaches here, I've tried to lay out three, where you have the breach, which by a lot of regulations would be something like an impermissible use or disclosure of information, and that impermissible use or disclosure has an impact, so financial impact, reputational impact, or harm. You'll find this more and more in the courts, that they're saying somebody's using it without authorization or without permission, and then they're doing something that's really bad. And those are two tests. But a sophisticated breach comes up all the time, and especially in conferences like RSA. And people will say, you just don't understand how sophisticated this breach is. And you just don't understand by looking at the data what we really have to do. And this is something that we have to deal with as an industry, and I don't think we have a good definition yet. But I like to use Einstein's definition, where he said, if you can't explain it simply, you don't understand it well enough. And I think this characterizes why some breaches are sophisticated. We don't understand them. So the third one is the advanced persistent breach, which is sort of a joke, a pun, if you will, on advanced persistent threat. But the bottom line here is it's a breach that really lasts for a long time, and it's very targeted. So I'll address all three of these, hopefully. And if there are questions, I hope to address them afterwards. If you'd like to approach me, please do, and I'd be happy to answer those questions. So let's look at the sources of information. There's a ton of information flooding in from lots of different sources. Some of these names may be familiar to you. You may have read the reports. I tried to read them all. But what's really interesting to me now is not just that companies that provide services to protect you against breaches are out there telling you how bad it is, but that the government itself has taken a role in collecting information. And so you see now, under the new HITECH Act, that the secretary must post a list of breaches of unsecured protected health information that has affected more than 500 individuals. So now we have a central repository at the US government of breach information. And I believe this is the beginning of a trend you'll see worldwide of sort of a list of people who have been breached. You might say it's the list where you can go and see who's been publicly shamed by breaches that have happened to them, which may be a little more reliable than some of the more targeted approaches, which I'll talk about here when we look first at TrustWave Spider Labs. They say that they looked at 300 investigations in 18 countries, and out of that, they found 20% had an unknown method of entry and a 33% unknown origin. Scary numbers, because even that small number of investigations, imagine if they had done 3,000 or 300,000 investigations and we had a 33% unknown origin. But let's look at another source, Verizon. They looked at only 834 cases, which had 33,000 attack steps. So they said there are only 54 intersections where agent and action, using their model, actually has some relevance, which means agent being a person or somebody they could identify was actually doing something that they could discuss as an actual action. That's the intersection. So 54 out of 834 cases were something we could really dig into and get really good data. Also notice from Verizon that they had a 40% hospitality and a 25% retail percentage. So when you look at breach data, you often end up looking at a source that may be very, very focused, hospitality and retail. Maybe that's not your sector. Maybe that has nothing to do with you. And then also look at the threat sources. Perhaps the most interesting statistic for me in the Verizon report, which I find to be very reliable, is that 3% of the threats are coming from China. They say 50% are coming from China if you count the last hop of origin, but it's only 3% that they could actually tie back to China. So that might help just right off the bat. You hear all the news about China attacking us, but when we trace it back, maybe it's a much smaller percentage. Maybe it's a last hop scenario. So from there, we jump to Trend Micro. And they have a look back at 2011 where they say it's a year of data breaches. So hopefully this year there won't be any, but I think that's optimistic. Really what they're saying here, if I look at the report, is that India and Russia are primary sources of spam. That's a fascinating statistic for me, because then when I look at Sophos, I see something very different. The United States is 12% and India is 8%. Even more interesting, perhaps, in the Sophos report is then you notice that Asia is 45% of the continent and Europe is 26%, even though the country, the United States, is 12%. So a lot of these reports have a lot of interesting statistics, and they really, at the end of the day, make a lot of contradictory statements. It could be the US, it could be Asia, it could be the continent, as Asia is bigger than North America. How do we make sense of it all? How do we figure out a true message out of all of the data that we're getting? So I looked to the past for some sort of guidance. And perhaps the best example of guidance using data comes from the cholera epidemic of 1854. This is when epidemiology was really started and when public policy was influenced by a study of disaster. So 600 deaths really starting at the end of August happened, and a person who was living there, Dr. John Snow, in the area of the deaths, started an investigation. He had a pedigree already. He had done cholera investigations before, and he had already published something which, with his own money, tried to prove that there is a mode of communication of cholera. His book was widely panned. People didn't believe it. They didn't think he proved anything. But in 1854, when it actually hit, when cholera was an epidemic in the city and people were dying left and right around him, he took it upon himself to prove his book and to convince the parish council to remove a pump handle that was connected to the threat. So if we look at this, this is the map that he used and why it was so influential. The X in the dark center is the pump. The deaths are mapped to that pump so that areas outside the pump, people weren't dying. If we blow it up, it looks something like this. You can see the dots are expanding in the area closest to that pump. He used a mathematical way of building a path, basically. So he would follow people's walking path to the pump to figure out, you know, how far away it was. People who lived closest were the ones who seemed to be dying. Even more important, however, notice the big gap in the lower right corner. It was a brewery. So you might think, okay, that's funny. People were drinking beer, that's why they didn't die from water poisoning. But in fact, even more important was the fact that the brewery, because it was making beer, had its own source of water. So nobody at the brewery died. So that big gap actually tells us more about proof of what the cause of death is or what the cause of risk is than the actual dots next to it. So let's apply this somehow. What I'd like to do today is go back to the trust waves, go back to the Verizons, go back to all of the reports that we have and look at them now in a new light and try to say, are we mapping the deaths to the actual cause? Are we finding the pump handles? Because that should be what we're focused on when we do breach reports. So again, trust wave here has a bias of 78% towards food and beverage industry and retail. So does their breach report really apply to other people in other fields? You can see here it's 89% customer records and 76% related to partners. Let me focus on that for a second. Partners, 76%. That means third parties are getting in. Shouldn't we stop all partner interaction? It seems like that could be the best way to stop breaches. Let's move on to the next though. Verizon. Let's take a different perspective. Partners, 0%. So here we think maybe we shouldn't be stopping partner connections at all. It hasn't had an influence at all this year. They say it's down from 22%, a far lower number than TrustWave. So now we're starting to think, wow, what could be the cause? Another note in the Verizon report is social network attacks are just 5% of social engineering. So now instead of looking backwards, if we're looking forwards and we think, okay, social networks are going to be the future attack. We hear all about Facebook, we hear all about these different modes of communication. Why isn't it a bigger effect? Because only 5% of social engineering. So let's look again at Verizon. Verizon actually has some hints in here, which I like, because they tell you things you can do to actually fix the breaches. First of all, they say your response time should be below 2 hours. So I think that's very good advice. I totally agree with that. The faster you can respond to a breach, the lower the harm. It's very obvious to me. I hope it's obvious to other people that you need to have a very good incident response plan in place. But the second thing might not be so obvious. You can scan for just 5 ports. They find over and over again that there are just a few things that you should look for which will reduce the chance of you being breached, because those are the ways people are getting in. That's probably much more effective than saying something like 76% come from partners. So what you really should be looking at are ways that attackers are using over and over again. It's like looking for the way cholera is coming through the pump because it's distributing water. So the third thing I want to highlight here is that you only need to stop one attack step. They say there are 4.7 steps to an attack. So if there are 5 steps on average for every attack, you should focus on those 5 steps. You only have to stop one of those 5 steps. The attack doesn't get any further into your environment. This should narrow it down quickly. Because what we're really looking at now is not, are there partners involved? Is it the retail sector? Is it the bank sector? But it's more about what are the methods being used in each sector and what are the steps we can use to stop each path of attack. So let's put it together. The first thing I find is that perimeter improvements are actually working. A lot of people say firewalls, old technology, perimeters, old technology. People are getting around and going over them. But that doesn't mean we should stop it. The way blacklists work, even if just 12% success comes from a malware tool that's doing blacklisting, that's 12% that you're stopping. So maybe leave that fence up. Just don't trust it as the only mechanism. You might want to improve it to 15, 20%, but it's still an effective mechanism at that 12%. Second, you see that attacks are focusing on exceptions. So they're looking at tokens, they're looking at bring your own device, so you have Apple's and Android devices, and then they're looking at backdoor. Those five ports, that's what you want to be looking for. So the third is that any and every asset is a target. And the fourth is that although the source of attacks is mostly unknown, there's a social aspect to it. So if we want to go back and figure out where they're coming from, let's look at it as a social function. Let's look at how they communicate with each other, because they're obviously talking to each other before they attack. So if I put this into a quick graph, I promise to do a little bit of graph manipulation, I've noticed something like this. Social Security numbers going up, credit cards staying down. In 2009, I predicted that we'd see a decrease in credit card attacks. We actually sort of flatlined, but it hasn't gone up. And this is very important to me because I'm noticing that things like the PCI Security Standards Council is doing a good job and the effects we're having there are positive. We're not seeing a huge spike in the number of breaches. Social Security numbers, on the other hand, has a rapid increase and decrease. So we might need to do more work there. If we look at it in terms of records, I turned into a heat map. You can see here that there are a few very large breaches, but overall, from those outliers, we've been fairly consistent, right? The attack vectors, as I mentioned, are coming through from a few areas. So those attack vectors we can focus on are default or weak credentials. We can look at the lack of input filtering, we can look at the excessive services, and we can look at the fringe systems. Not just mobile, but anything that's new. So Apple is out in the fringe, digital is out on the fringe too because it's old. So if you have VAXs sitting around, you might want to look at those a little more carefully because they might have services that are exploited, or people might be on them already and you're not looking for activity. So if I go back to the... I'm going backwards. There we go. The four-step attack process. If we go to the four-step attack process, we see how people get in, what they do. They enumerate all the systems. They get access to those systems. They take control of those systems, and then they expand and repeat. So those are the steps we're trying to stop. And if we take samples like anonymous and lulzsec, or virtualization, cloud, certificates, tokens, and material, these are the areas I'll talk about in more depth when I give my full presentation. And these are the areas that we're trying to really dig into and figure out how we could stop anonymous. In the anonymous case, with lulzsec, in this particular case in AT&T, it's a VPN access example. This person was given access and they abused it. If we look at something like virtualization, again, in the Shinogi case, this person was given VPN access and they abused it. He came in from a McDonald's account. He basically went to McDonald's, bought breakfast, got on his wireless VPN, went in and deleted all the servers. If we look at the cloud, the Epsilon case, we can see that basically 40 billion emails come out of the Epsilon environment a year. When somebody went in and breached that environment, the impact was massive. And so the people who are trying to come in might have a particular impact in mind. In this case, it might be trying to get email addresses. We used to think only credit card numbers were assets, but really the asset definition has changed dramatically, as Epsilon proves. If we look at the DigiNotar certificate case, we can see that people are trying to get in to get control of certificates. Again, the asset definition has changed. But even more important, DigiNotar, we treated as a trusted ally. We treated them as somebody who would protect certificates, when in fact we found that they weren't keeping track of the certificates, they had infrastructure that had major weakness, and there was a response in terms of failure. There was a failed response in terms of time. So if we look at DigiNotar, what we find is that, in fact, we may not want to trust some partners because they don't pass our simple tests, but we might still want to trust other partners. In terms of tokens, we have the RSA example, and we also have the sticky pot. Both cases, people are trying to get control of tokens, and they're trying to get control of certificates because they're trying to get in from the outside. If we look at material breaches, as the SEC has recently defined for us, so any material information regarding cybersecurity risks, look at the RockYou password email attack. The ruling that came out recently was that passwords are actually material to a company. So if you lose passwords because someone gets them, this can be a material impact to the company. Or in other words, the people who say they lost their passwords can actually claim that as harm, back to my definition of a breach. So the breach is changing, the scope is changing of assets that you have to protect in these examples. And finally, if you look at the Google Dorks example, there are a lot of ways that information can be exposed just because you're allowing it into your company to go out into search engine space. So people are able to find passwords, they're able to run simple tests that pull your entire database and expose your passwords on the internet. So breaches are really changing. So what are we going to do about it? To get through this quickly, the message in the bottle is that we need to respond to those four steps. We need to consider all material assets when scoping, not just a few things. To stop the breaches, we have to treat everything as an asset that's really material. Second, we have to spot smaller and more frequent attacks. And third, we have to reduce incentives. So how are we going to do that? Here are some defensive strategies. I don't want to talk about those four things. I want to talk about just three things. If we take virtualization, if we take automation, and we take a hackback strategy, I think we have a good chance of stopping them. So first, if we look at Anonymous as the new auditor, it's a great thing. They're out there finding things for us. They're proving things are vulnerable. That changes the game, because as auditors come in, we can say, if we're not going to find this, Anonymous will find this. So it's more like a super assessment. It's actually moving along on a super collaboration model, or hacktivism model, if you will. And so we're really working in a space now where auditors are being assisted by the Anonymous threat. And second, the insider end user has become highly, highly targeted. So a lot of the frequent attacks that are coming from lots more sources, not just the regular auditor, but actually from the Anonymous auditor, if you will. And they're coming towards very targeted, smaller spaces. So we have to look at every individual being attacked from possibly every source. Second, we have to reduce incentives. So this creates increased pressure for hackback. And what I mean by that is that a lot of people have access to tools now that they can do attacks much more easily. We can see an accumulation of wealth by people who are attacking us. So we have to take that as an example of how we can find people who might be attacking us, rapid increase in wealth. It used to be used all the time, but now we can do it even better using the internet. And third, we can track collaboration. So we can actually find that people are doing collaboration to do an attack, as has been proven in several different attack scenarios. So if we reduce incentives by going back and profiling the people who are attacking us and taking a hackback approach, then if you look at the defensive methods, we can use virtualization. And here are some examples of how we can use virtualization. We can use some automation. Here's some examples of how we can use automation. In particular, we can do the same thing that the attackers are doing to us, but back to them. In other words, if somebody attacks a virtual system, you can quickly replace that system with another. It becomes a honeypot. You can trap them, profile them, figure out what they're doing. The other system now is serving happily without those people getting to it, because you're simply tracking those particular people and all of their movements. You can then automatically control things because you're using new standards like the XCCD from NIST. So another great message. But finally, the point I really want to get to is that with hackback, we can establish a legal framework using public policy, just like they did with the cholera epidemic. We can go back to people who are attacking us and say, we are allowed to do defensive action. And this is the conference where I'm going to announce my company is going to have a hackback strategy. We'll help you figure out how and when and where and how you'll go to attack people, but not just so that you can go out and stop people in terms of communication, but how you can profile that threat and understand better why they're attacking you, and therefore understand the breach better. Once you understand something like cholera, you can figure out that it's the dirty water and the pump handle that's causing the attacks, and therefore you can stop it more effectively. Thank you for your time.